Hi, this video is on the basic types of statistical studies, and if you need the worksheet, you can go to my website, caroleemath.com. And I have three different types of statistical studies here. You may be familiar with a lot of these words from reading about experiments or hearing about experiments in the media. So let's look at three different examples and talk about the vocabulary. Okay, the first one is an observational study. And here's an example. Researchers examined health records of thousands of males to determine whether there was a relationship between family history and heart attack. Okay, so in this case, they're just looking at health records. They're not giving them medication or asking them to exercise. They're simply observing. And so there's no treatment being given to these folks. That's what makes it an observational study. Okay, so observational means no treatment is given. Some studies are just observational. Sometimes you can't give a treatment for ethical reasons, and so all we can do is observe records. Okay, the next type is an actual experiment. Here's an example of that. Researchers want to investigate whether taking aspirin regularly reduces the risk of heart attack. 400 people who identify as men are divided randomly into two groups. One group will take aspirin, the other group will take a sugar pill. At the end of the study, researchers count the number of men in each group who have had a heart attack. Okay, this time we are giving a treatment. So this is an experiment. We are actively imposing some kind of something, treatment, medication, exercise, diet, something that people are actually changing. Okay, so that's an experiment. Let's talk about each of these vocabulary words in relation to this example. Okay, so treatment group. Let's see. 400 people are divided randomly into two groups. Okay, I'm assuming that they're equal in each group. So this would be 200 people who received the treatment. Okay, that is the treatment we want to study, so we need to give people the treatment. We also have a control group. One group will take aspirin, the other group, oh, in this case, let's write that too. In this case, the treatment is aspirin. The control group, so the other group will take a sugar pill. So the control group, think about if we did a study and we gave everyone aspirin. And oh, we got these great results. But how would you know if the results were due to the aspirin or just, something inherent to that group? So we need to separate it. We need two groups. We need a control group. So the control group is the baseline group. They do not get a treatment. Okay, they may get a placebo, which we'll talk about in a minute. So in this case, they do not get the aspirin. Okay. Random selection. So it also says they're divided randomly into two groups. Let's think about why they would need to be divided. Okay, so let's say we've got 400 people, and let's say we just said, okay, you guys go in this group and you guys go in this group. Or 55 and under, you go in this group. 56 and older, you go in this group. Well, we need to make sure that we're controlling for all the factors, right? Especially that age one. We wouldn't want to separate by age because then age is another factor. We want to only look at the effect of aspirin. And so the reason we want random selection is we want to even out all the other factors into both groups. And the only way we can really do that is randomly. Okay, so we assign the groups randomly. And that is to spread out all other factors. For example, age is one that I mentioned, and maybe history, health history. We need to spread all those things out so that we're sure that the effect is actually due to the aspirin and not due to something else, which would be called a lurking variable. Just like you can lurk on the internet, variables can lurk and be hidden. Okay, so let's talk about placebo now. A placebo, in this case, is the sugar pill. So a placebo is a fake treatment. Now, I bet you know, you can pause it for a minute if you want to, I bet you know why someone's given a fake treatment. Did you figure out why? So the fake treatment is given to reduce the psychological effect. Have you ever started a new medication or a new exercise program or a new anything? Just the act of getting something or starting something new can actually give someone an improvement in their condition. So think about if you're, okay, I'm going to be in the study, and then it turns out you're not in the treatment group. How would you feel? Or you are in the treatment group or you're not in the treatment group. So those not in the treatment group would probably be pretty disappointed. They're participating in this study and they know they're not going to get anything out of it. So that's why we need to give them a placebo, which has to do with blinding. Okay, so the placebo is a fake treatment given to reduce or hopefully eliminate the psychological effect. Now, I think that psychological effect is really powerful and should be harnessed more in treatments, but that's what that placebo effect is, what I was describing. Just the act of getting a treatment may help someone improve. The act of getting a treatment may help someone improve in whatever the condition is. Maybe have fewer heart attacks. Okay, so this is really important. We need to randomly select, so we need our people to be randomly spread out in the two different groups. And then we're going to give a placebo, which is the classic example is the sugar pill, but they have to look the same so that the subjects don't know. So some half the group is given a placebo, a fake treatment, a sugar pill. Half the group is getting aspirin. That way we can compare the results of the treatment group to the results of the control group and see if these are statistically significantly higher or better than this group. And then we'll know that it's actually due to taking the aspirin and not due to something else. Let's move this up. Okay, so blinding, I mentioned it, it has to do with the placebo. The placebo is actually used for blinding. A single blind experiment means that the subjects don't know which treatment they're getting. I need a different color. That is very important to reduce that psychological effect. If someone knows, oh, I'm getting this treatment, I'm sure it's going to help. If someone knows they're not getting a treatment, that's going to be really disappointing. Double blind is when the subjects and the researchers don't know who's in which group. They're both blind. And you could imagine maybe if a researcher knows, let's say a doctor knows that this person is in the treatment group, they might subtly, consciously or unconsciously, treat that person differently or do something differently than a person that they know is in the control group. So it's very important that the researchers don't know who is in which group so that we can take out any unconscious bias or conscious bias from the study. So double blind is researchers and subjects are blind to who is in which group. Okay, I don't think it says in this example. We can definitely say this one is single blind because it says they will take a sugar pill. So that's a placebo, which means they are blind. You wouldn't say, here's your sugar pill. So if there's a placebo, then it is a single blind study. Some things are really hard to give a placebo for. For example, exercise. How could you say, okay, you exercise and you don't exercise? You know if you're exercising or not, and there's no fake exercise. People have been trying to find that for years. So, some things are hard to make a placebo for, hard to blind. Okay, double blind means the researchers and the subjects are blind. Okay, so that's an experiment. When we do an experiment, and you'll hear randomized controlled experiment, then we can conclude causation. So let's put that up here. A treatment is given, can conclude causation. All right, so if we randomly assign the treatments, they're blind, we have a treatment group and a control group, and if the treatment group is significantly better, statistically significant results, significantly better than the control group, we could say that yes, aspirin does reduce heart attacks. And really, the big key is the randomization, because all of the other factors should be randomly split between the two groups. Okay, now let's back up just one second. But with an observational study, we cannot conclude causation. We're not controlling for anything in the observational study. We're looking at health records, thousands of males, to determine a relationship between family history and heart attack. So we could have a relationship between family history and heart attack, but there may be other factors involved. So there could be a lurking variable involved that is actually causing the relationship. So because we don't have a control group and we don't have the randomization, we cannot conclude causation from an observational study. However, there are some things we can only study by observing, so they have their place. Sometimes people will do an observational study to try to see if there's a relationship because it's less expensive. Then they might design, if they feel like there is a relationship, then they might design an experiment, which takes probably more time, more money, etc. Okay, let's move this up to the third one, which is observational case controlled. So it is an observational like the first one. That means no treatment is given. That That's just part of observational. And let's see if we can see what the case controlled means. So a group of disabled women, age 65 and older, was tracked for several years, ending in 2010. Those who had a vitamin B12 deficiency were found to be twice as likely to suffer severe depression as those who did not. Okay, so while it is observational, we seem to have two categories here, right? Those who had a vitamin B12 deficiency and those who did not. And so that's why they call it case controlled. This kind of simulates an experiment, right? Because you've got a control group. So the subjects were separated into two categories. But remember, we're still only observing. Subjects were separated into two categories. So we have those who had a B12 deficiency and those who did not. Okay, then they were comparing the two groups. Those who did have a vitamin B12 deficiency were found to be twice as likely to suffer severe depression as those who did not. So could we say that having a vitamin B12 deficiency causes severe depression? No, we cannot. What if there's something else that causes a B12 deficiency and severe depression? Or what if there are other factors that are similar or that are present in people with a B12 deficiency versus those who don't have the B12 deficiency? So there could be lurking variables there. So again, because it is not randomized, we cannot conclude causation. So that's my caution here. Even though it looks like an experiment, still no treatment was given. And so we cannot conclude causation because there's two things I want to say. Either the lurking variable or we don't have randomization. Let's try to put both. Because randomization was not used, so there could be a lurking. Let's put it over here. One or more lurking variables, something that's actually causing the relationship between the vitamin B12 deficiency and severe depression. So what researchers could do is they've seen this relationship twice as likely to suffer severe depression as those who did not. They could then take subjects who have severe depression and give them vitamin B12, right? Design an experiment, a randomized controlled experiment, to give folks vitamin B12 and see if the treatment group is statistically significantly higher or better than the control group. Okay, one last thing I wanna do just to make all these even. We had the first one cannot conclude causation, the second one can, and this third one cannot conclude causation because it is an observational study. Scoot that over. Okay, that is the video for basic types of statistical studies, and I'll see you in the next one.